The gift that looks good on you.
You are born with a grace.
The gift that looks good on you.
That grace is your gift.
The gift that looks good on you.
It's a divine enablement.
The gift that looks good on you.
If you work your grace, the grace will work for you. Company, teach the lesson.
Systems of the world
systems.
Try to take your confidence.
Yes, they will.
For these systems were designed to make you doubt what heaven said.
Don't you doubt.
The systems of the world.
These systems
try to take your confidence.
Yes, they will.
For these systems were
designed
to make you sit down on your kid.
Don't you let.
But the gift God gave to you.
Welcome, Shante. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
So I came across your Instagram account, and I saw some hilarious reels, so I know this interview is going to be so much fun, but before we get started, we're going to open up in prayer, and then I want to jump right in.
All right.
Father Jesus, today we thank you for today. We thank you for this interview. We ask you to bless Shante. Lord, we ask you to let something be said to encourage that mom, that entrepreneur, that business owner, that wife out there on the other side of the camera. We just ask that you have your way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right, so Shante,
yes.
Share with us your background, where you grew up, your former career, family. Just tell us about yourself.
Okay. No, just kidding. So I am from Cookeville, Pennsylvania. I was born and raised there until I was 16 years old, and then, you know, life happens. My parents separated, and me and my brother and my father moved to Philadelphia, and I tried moving back to Cookeville when I got pregnant with my oldest son, Judah, but it's just something about being able to take a bus whenever you need to. I moved back to Philadelphia looking for, you know, another job, another path, all the things. And I've been here ever since, really. I used to work at a daycare center, and I got my husband a job there when he, at the time, he was just my friend.
Not anymore.
No, I'm just kidding. And so he was just my friend. And then, you know, we started to date again. We were friends for about 6 years, and then we got married, and then I had two more children, and I started working at my father-in-law's job, who is my pastor. Started working there just with children, and then I got promoted to the accounts payable specialist. It was a long journey, but we'll just leave it there. I was there for 5 years, and then I got laid off. So I used my severance package to invest in my business. At first, I just thought it would just be graphic design, but then I started gaining clients from all over the country and decided to just change my title to virtual assistant. And I'm here doing that.
All right. So, you posted a quote, and I'm going to read your quote.
Oh, my.
You said,
the files.
Losing my job used to be one of my biggest fears.
Oh, yeah.
My biggest fear turned into my favorite testimony.
Yeah.
I'm a full-time business owner. Yahweh is my shepherd. Mm-hmm. I lack nothing. That was a powerful statement. Could you share with us your initial feelings, thoughts when you got laid off?
Oh, I was just the betrayal. Now, I had been there for 5 years. I was there longer than some of the people. I was there longer than the person who pulled me in the office to lay me off. I'm like, oh my goodness, this is terrible. And I was scared. At first, I'm like, yeah, I'm just going to start my own business. And people were like, well, what are you going to do after this? And I'm like, I'm going to run my own business. And I had to say it with confidence because the enemy loves to take occasion with your downfalls and likes to take occasion with your thoughts when something like this happens. It's like, well, God, I thought you were my provider. He is my provider. But me saying, even saying, I thought you were my provider is the enemy whispering in my ear like, providing for you, girl, like, why are you doing this? But I had to say it with confidence. I had to say it with faith. I had to say it like, yeah, thank you for this, to like the people who laid me off. Like, I just needed that lump sum of cash so I could start my business, so thank you. But it was a I felt betrayed. I was hurt, but I did not want to show it. So I didn't start to feel the emotions until after I was done with them completely.
Wow. So how did your experience at that last job prepare you for your business that you're now working?
It really taught me customer service, to be honest with you. It was a nonprofit organization. People calling constantly to get their money, and I'm saying that was my job. My job was to pay the bills. So when people call, like, oh, my invoice is past due, this and the third. Now I'm calling people, hey, your invoice is past due. When are you going to pay this? This is the policy. This is that. This is this. So I know how to do my own books. I can help clients do their books if I want to. Really anything that they need as far as accounts payable, I can help with. I just really don't want to. I want to do the fun stuff, you know. I want to do the design. I want to do the voiceover work. I want to do all of those things and then help them push their brand.
Okay. So you, on your site and everything, you talk about you are a creative virtual assistant. Mm-hmm. What is that? Can you tell us what that is?
Something I made up. No, just kidding. So a creative virtual assistant is, so there are different ones. So there's like the admin one. I call that the basic VA. No tea, no shade. No, I say that as a joke. No shade. It's just, they just do the basic administrative work like calendar management, scheduling, all of those things. Phone calls, I do those things too. But the creative virtual assistant helps push a brand. So I'm a graphic designer. So if they come to me and they need updates to their website, but they don't want to pay somebody $4,000 to reconstruct the whole thing, they can just ask me to do it and pay me by the hour. And then that will be my task for the week.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. So how do you get clients? What is that process?
So I went viral on Instagram by accident, like a few times. And It just started to happen. And basically what I do is I post relatable content for business owners who might need me. And they, you know, click the link in my bio, schedule a consultation, and then we start working together if I'm a good fit for them and they're a good fit for me. So yeah, that's basically what it is. Or they reach out in my inbox.
Okay. So yeah, why a virtual assistant?
So when people come to me for design work, they usually don't know where to go next. How do I get my LLC? Where do I go for a website? This, that. So I said, if I'm doing this and helping people set up their Instagram, set up their Facebook, set up their LinkedIn, set up their TikTok, making videos, content, and things like that, and I'm doing all of that virtually for free, why not help them and charge a fee?
Right.
That rhymes.
Okay. So, how long have you been in business, and what are some of your biggest challenges being a virtual assistant?
On July 29th, it'll be my first complete year in business. Okay. That was my last day packing up my desk, but I was, well, I can't get fired or anything. I was, like, running my business while I was on the job, like, answering phones. I started off answering phones for a friend, and while I was doing my accounts payable work, I would answer phones for him. But, so that's why I'm able to say, like, I officially started my business July 29, because the next day I had stuff to do. I had to get myself together.
Wait, and I was so making flyers. You had already had this business in the work?
A little bit, but it was just for like graphic design. So I'm okay. Like, oh, I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna, oh, who needs a flyer? But of course, I was undercharging myself for everything, girl. Voiceover work, websites, everything. People would see my price list and they're like, why are you charging that? I'm like, because people are saying it's too expensive. If they say it's too expensive, they're not your client. Mm-hmm. They just don't have the money.
Right.
They don't go to Walmart and say, well, that's too much money. You know? They don't go to the register and say, listen, I picked this out and I need it, but I can't afford this. They don't call the police on you.
Right.
So yeah.
That makes sense.
Oh, the challenges.
Yes.
One of the challenges, and this is still very fresh, I had a very awful situation with a client where I was being threatened. And it's because I did not set boundaries. So that is a challenge in my business, setting boundaries, because I love helping people and people play on that. And I know people say, oh, I just love to see people win, blah, blah, blah. No, I actually like helping people. I actually like helping, seeing them win. So they play on that. They want to talk to me on the phone for hours, but I charge by the hour. And when it's time to pay, nobody wants to pay. So I just told my husband, like, the day that I decided to let this client go, because you can fire clients, the day I decided to let her go, I had the worst mental health scare in my life. And my whole family suffered because of it. And I told myself that I wouldn't let it happen again. And recently just had the same situation just happen. Not as bad, but thankfully, with prayer, deliverance, and a sound mind, okay, come on, a sound mind, I was able to just get through that situation and kind of just forget about it. I'm like, oh, I don't work with this person anymore. It's a weight off of my shoulders. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, letting clients go is a challenge.
So, you posted some hilarious reels about just interactions with clients. Mm-hmm. What are some of the funniest situations that you've had with your clients?
I don't even know. Because, so, like, there's a client I meet with every Monday and Thursday. Every time we meet, it's a good time. And she does things. I was like, you're not yourself today. And she was like, I've never met her in person, but we talk like we've seen each other all the time. And she's like, hold on, I got you. And she puts on these heart-shaped sunglasses. I'm like, ma'am, like, I'm not doing this today with you. That was, you know, a funny situation. I try not to be a goofball because I want people to take me seriously. But, like, sometimes I just can't help it. So I'll be able to tell them about themselves, now you know you're doing too much. Like, different things like that.
Okay. So, transitioning, mm-hmm. You are a wife. Mm-hmm. Wife of assistant pastor, mm-hmm. A mother, yeah. An author, illustrator. How do you balance all of that? What does self-care look like for you?
Self-care for me, I like to get my nails done, but as you can see, I have not done that in a couple weeks because school is out. Why? I don't know. Like, keep them there. Like, no, I'm just kidding. The school is out, and I decided that it would be a good idea to keep my children home. It's going okay, but, like, I just need school to open back up. I don't care how much money we got to spend on school supplies and uniforms. Just get out. No, I'm just kidding. For real, I like to turn on my music, light a candle, and take a bubble bath for a couple hours. Like, you ever see that meme that says, like, women get in a bathtub and forget they have a family? That is me. I do that.
So, you also have a book, mm-hmm. called Jude and Desmond. Keep the Sabbath. Mm-hmm. So what inspired you to write this book?
So, I grew up apostolic, and I've always had books and picture books and different things to help me understand Bible stories, but there isn't really a book out there to help you understand what the Sabbath day is. So I wrote that book basically to give my children a guide, but it has also served as it basically fills in the gap for people who look at people who keep the Sabbath as people who believe something different. I believe in the same Jesus that saved you because he saved me. I believe in God. You know, I might call him Yahweh, but I call him God too. It's just on the outside looking in, it might look like we're doing something completely different because when, you know, growing up apostolic, doing anything different is different, okay, for everybody all around. I even have my old pastor's wife reach out to me and ask me, this was my pastor when I was a teenager, I see you have a new faith. I'm like, a new faith? No. I believe in Jesus. What's up with you? So, but I wrote that book so that my children can have something to look at and know
when the Sabbath day is, what Shabbat Shalom means, which is just peaceful Sabbath, and what we do on the Sabbath day, and they get it. So,
okay, where can we purchase your book?
So right now it's available on Amazon. I do have books on hand for like vendor events and stuff like that, but it is available on Amazon under Judah and Desmond Keep the Sabbath.
And that's it. So are there any other projects that you're working on that yes. we can support you with?
So I am working on another book. I've already written it. I just have to draw the pictures, but as you can see, I have a lot going on. I am working to build a nonprofit organization in Philadelphia to help our young people learn clerical skills. They can do virtual assistant, they can do graphic design and all those things, because it just really hurts my feelings when I see young people write out sentences and they're not complete. Their subject verb agreement is a little off. I'm like, okay, like, it's just nobody sat down and taught you how to do this. And I went to high school in Philadelphia for 2 years and noticed a huge difference from the high school that I went to in Coatesville. It is completely different. Even the curriculum is different. So I understand it. It's not their fault. So why not give them a hand? Why not teach them how to write an email? Teach them how to put a subject in the email and not the whole email in the subject like some people do. People make millions of dollars and do that. Like, what's wrong with you? So I'm working on that, and it's not just for young people, it's for people who want to start their business. Usually for coaching I do charge, but for the city of Philadelphia it is going to be free once I get it up and running.
Okay. That's cool. Definitely let us know. Mm-hmm. Now the books that you write, are they geared towards children more so?
So, yeah, for right now, I just feel like adults are really hard to please. And then there's a whole proofreading thing. You can proofread the thing 6 or 7 times and it'll still be a word spelled wrong. So, I don't have anything like that yet. I have thought about it before, but there's just so many tears involved. And maybe that's what I'll call it, tears involved, because it's just so many things. I laugh and joke a lot, but I've been through a lot. And I do want to share my story one day, but I don't know if a book is the avenue, but yeah, for right now, just children.
Okay. And just one more question. What's the hardest thing about writing a book?
The hardest thing about writing a book is, like I said, the proofreading. I have someone else do it for me, but it's like, oh my God, there's something wrong with it. Oh my God, when it comes to me, it's going to be something wrong with it. That's the hard part, getting people to buy it. But thankfully, I've had sales every month. With Judah and Doesn't Keep the Sabbath. So,
how long ago did you write that book?
I wrote that book last year and released it on my birthday
of this year,
of 2022.
Okay.
Yeah. But actually, no. I started writing it in 2021 when I was pregnant with my son Braxton. But I did not know whether or not Braxton was a boy or a girl. So I just put it out there. So I wrote it, and I was like, I'll just write another one and include Braxton. Yeah. Oh, like, goodness gracious. I already drew the pictures. I'm not drawing another baby in here. No, I'm just kidding.
So, I want to have a little fun. Uh-oh. We're 90s babies, mm-hmm. So I want to play a little trivia.
Oh, don't do that.
All right.
I grew up in church. Is it church questions?
Seriously. So, I'm going to ask you a question, and I want you to just tell me what this thing is.
Oh, Lord.
So, number one, you ready?
A pager. No, I'm just kidding.
What is AOL?
Oh, that's like, you know, America Online, right? We used to send the chats, but Elder Bowman, my dad, used to have a block on our chat. So, I was Church Girl 228. That's my screen name. So, look me up on AOL. Make sure your mama not using the phone.
What is Blockbusters, or what was Blockbusters?
So I went to Hollywood movies, Hollywood videos. So okay. Blockbusters was for the bougie people who live next to Domino's Pizza.
All right. What does it mean to burn a CD?
Is this being shown to the police?
Wait a minute.
Who did? Because when Tyshirt and GA came out, the Victory album, I burned that CD.
Just playing. No, just saying. I burned that CD. It's copying a CD, but it wasn't illegal until LimeWire came out.
What is the electric slide?
Something that I'm glad I know how to do. It's a line dance. But don't ask me how to do it unless the music goes on.
What is a beeper?
It's like this, the new age Apple Watch. No, the old age Apple Watch. They said if you got your Apple Watch on in the picture, it looks like you got a pager on your hip. It's like a communication thing, cell phone.
What is a landline?
You know, the house phone.
That my 85-year-old grandma has.
Yep. That's okay. Ain't nobody calling for the bill collectors.
All right, a few more. What is an easy bake oven?
I love making a little an easy bake oven. It's like a little microwave for children, basically. You made a powder and the water mix, and you put it in an oven, and you got a cake. Period.
What is MySpace?
The start of my graphic design career. Hello. I used to hook people's pages up, okay? I used to have their names raining down from the thing. I did.
Why would someone hit star 69 before making a phone call?
Because he just broke up with you and now you can say call him and he's gonna answer. To block the phone call. Now AT&T wanna tell on people that this look like this number. Like when it says unknown caller and this it still has the number there. So it doesn't work anymore.
Shante, thank you for being okay.
No problem.
But before we go, can you just give a word of encouragement to that mom, that business owner, that wife, and offer a word of prayer?
Okay. Yeah. So, to the mom, business owner, and wife, it's okay to be yourself. I know it's about to rhyme and have a life. It's okay to have something outside of your family, but as a wife, you still have to take care of your family and your husband. But if you put that first, which I had to learn actually in the last few weeks, if you put that first, then you will be surprised how much the Lord blesses your business and endeavors. So put God first, put your family first, and then watch all of the blessings fall. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness. And all them good things, they gonna be added unto you. So, there's that.
I'm so nervous.
No, I'm just kidding.
and just close this out up
here. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for all that you've done, all that you're doing, and all that you're going to do. We thank you for this production. We ask you right now that you touch those who are out there watching, touch those who are listening. And we thank you for our host. We ask you right now that you continue to bless her and bless all of the things that she sets her hands out to do. Let this be bigger than what it is now. We don't just know how small beginnings, God, but we know that you are a God of increase. We thank you for all that you've done. We ask you right now that you protect us on our way home. Protect the viewers that are out there. Help them to turn their lives to you. Lord, allow them to feel your love through this broadcast. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Thank you for that.
No problem.
Remember, with God, all things are possible. Be blessed.